aircraft that utilizes air, but goes much faster. And of course, maybe some of these old buildings are a little bit older than the Twin Towers. So, start, so I just found a page that had most interesting things on it. Let's see, 245, I think it was. 245, 245, yes, 245. Here we go. So Wilson warmly received in France and UK. President Wilson has been greeted as a conqueror. Sweden, Norway, Finland, the Netherlands, USA. I thought it would be newspaper articles, maybe, but it doesn't look like it is. Max Planck, the celebrated German physicist, was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics today for his revolutionary discovery about the nature of energy. Working at the University of Berlin in the late 1890s, Planck sought to explain why existing formulas could not account for the emission of heat radiation by hot bodies. Described heat radiation accurately, but only by introducing a radical new concept. The idea that heat and all other forms of energy are not infinitely divisible. Instead, energy is emitted in small packages. Planck called such a packet a quantum. Not accepted in the world of physics for many years. Planck himself was even suspicious physicist. Sorry, I'm trying to say that without whistling. A mathematical physicist. That's hard. But he's so, he's just a powerhouse, an intellectual powerhouse. So we have the banner of revolution raised. Vice President in 1900 and became president after the 1901 assassination of William McKinley. Prohibition is ratified. Americans will have just a little less than a year to drink their fill, at least legally. It's interesting that they didn't even assume going to be banned, and it would, that people would stop drinking. A dry amendment adopted by the required number of states was proclaimed today as part of the Constitution, effective next January 16th. Statistics that, you know, 1,000% of all crimes are committed while people are drunk. Beer drinkers, beware of the Ides of March. Due to a shortage of raw materials, the popular beverage will be depleted nationally in March, with some northeastern taps drying up even earlier. The country will be on a straight whiskey basis, and in these days of unrest, it is dangerous to have a steady beer drinker's switch to whiskey. Well, 1919, first commercial Paris to London flight. They are very busy smoking. Soviet force. they're being held back by the timidity and cowardice of the Second or Socialist International. This older organization lost all solidarity once it had outbreak of war, when its members were consumed by nationalism. Yeah, that guy I just mentioned, Eric Weinstein, he's a mathematician, but he's also a fascinating figure because he's actually very well-spoken and extremely knowledgeable across he's a Renaissance man, for sure. And he was discussing that if there are going to be any global economies, it makes sense that you can't have it by force. You can't create transitions into capitalism necessarily by force, because, well, you can't start movements, I guess, external, because they have to be organic and local, because that's how things are best run in from the inside, not from the outside. That was his main point. Since last night, but Mussolini, interesting. on the page opposite catches in a single brilliant frame the distinctive mark of the modern era. The acceleration in the pace of history, a sailing ship for 20 centuries, the great means of human communication portrayed against the helicopters and mighty towers of the 20th century megalopolis. To be honest, I don't see any sort of key or elaboration on, I guess these just actually must be dates. They must be dates. But yeah, February 9th, and then it points to August 10th. So I guess that's how long that particular event lasted. Trip to the moon in 1919. They were thinking about a trip to the moon, which is pretty remarkable, because only, what, 14 years earlier, they had actually, Wright Brothers, successfully, I'm sure it's here somewhere, 1904. I bet it's source. You know, rocks, it looks like. Oh, okay. Oh, well. I'm Robert A. Goddard. Goddard, a professor of physics at Clark University in Massachusetts. Goddard has been experimenting with rockets since 1909. Demonstrated three models to the Army just before the armistice last year. Goddard's moon travel proposals being ridiculed by newspapers, which have dubbed him the Moon Man. There you go, folks. That's the epitome of what it takes to achieve something great. You're going to be publicly mocked because it doesn't A, seem possible, and B, doesn't go with what the mass all agree is contemporary and viable. Shows just how little wisdom the mass often has. And I think it's a hard feat psychologically to stick your head above the crowd and try to actually use facts and history and come up with your own opinion that might not necessarily agree with what is being projected and communicated by and to most people. It does take courage to speak your voice and your opinion, particularly when it dissents from the masses. It's people that do that project and propel our society forward. Alright, let's see what ones we can end with here. Mussolini tries to have the fame of Marx with the Fascist Manifesto. Jack Dempsey wins the heavyweight crown. Suzanne city of Fiume in an attempt to return it to Italy. D'Annunzio was provoked by the announcement of the Inter-Allied Military Commission that Italian troops in Fiume would be replaced by Maltese policemen. Conference recently decided that Fiume and Sarro will become free cities under the League of Nations supervision. Andrew Carnegie, looking the son of a Boer weaver, Carnegie immigrated into America, settling near Pittsburgh. He took a job as a bobbin boy in a cotton mill, became a telegraph messenger at age 14, and after a series of other jobs, he entered the steel business. At the time of his death, his estate was estimated to exceed $500 million. And during his lifetime, he poured about $350 million into various philanthropies, including a vast network of public libraries. The man who dies rich, thus, he once said, the man who dies thus rich dies disgraced. That's a positive note to wake up to fall asleep to there, guys. Because for as much as it seems easy as it seems to hate and be envious and be jealous and look upon the 1% as very greedy, if you look at the facts, look what Bill Gates doing. Look at what this guy Carnegie did. I mean, they give away millions and millions and millions of dollars. And aside from that, I think there's something to be learned off that. It's that there is a lot of money out there. And if you meet the right people, have access to it, but in a less selfish perspective, if you are doing something to really help the human race and doing something expertly and competently, I think there are a lot of people out there who want to help. With every disaster in Haiti and New Orleans, with Katrina and 9/11, everybody to just pour money at the situation, and I think that's a fact, you know. It's not just opinion, it's not just rhetoric, it's not propaganda. People are rich, and a lot of rich people want to give away money for a good cause. They know it's not going to get squandered. So for all the negativity in the world, let's keep our spirits up, and again, like always, try to be the best we can be. And here's to a better, restful sleep and a better tomorrow, guys. A much brighter. Every day is a little increment. You don't notice it because it's so close to the day before, but after a year, after a couple years, after a decade, I think our world is overall heading in the right direction. With enough scientists, mathematicians, engineers, and all the medical breakthroughs we're doing, we're becoming more powerful than ever, and I think we need a good moral compass, and we need to not be fragmented. Unified in the same direction, which should be lifting people out of poverty. And it looks like that's being more successful